greetings. What is the strong delusion? 2 Thessalonians 2:1. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him, that you be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. The church has expected Jesus to return since he originally left. The church believed this because of things Jesus said just before leaving. John 14:3, if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am you may be also. John 14:28, you heard me say, I am going away and I am coming back to you. If you loved me, you would be glad that I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. Matthew 16:27, for the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels, and then he will reward each person according to what he has done. Evidently, some had begun to circulate the rumor that Jesus had already come back. Verse 3, let no man deceive you by any means. I don't think we know if the rumors were by Christians or others seeking to confuse and confound the church. Paul could have said, let no man confuse you. He did not, and the word deceive has connotation of intent. And the spirit of deception is fully operating in the world today. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Paul gives two events that must first come before the return of the Lord. One, a falling away, and some quibble what this means. Two, the man of sin be revealed, also called the son of perdition. For that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Now, numbering those 1 and 2 comes from the usage of and, which implies and then. However, it is equally valid to read this potentially as the same event, that the revealing of the man of sin may cause people to fall away or lose faith. Regardless, keep in mind this must happen before the coming of that day, the day of the Lord, the day of Christ. If you believe the day of Christ is the rapture, then we will be here to see the Antichrist unveiled. We will be here during the falling away. Now, I have seen videos proposing that the falling away is better translated caught away or snatched away, hinting at this being the rapture. Sadly, the Greek word is not harpazo, but apostia, which we know as apostasy. That is the same thing they kill you for in Islam, leaving the faith, leaving the religion. The son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sits in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. This man will oppose God. This man will exalt himself above all that is called God. That may mean elevating himself above Jesus, who is called God by the Christians. It may mean elevating himself above the Jewish God, Yahweh, or that is worshipped. In fact, he may be above Allah, who is also worshipped, so that he as God sits in the temple of God. Since he will sit in the temple, this implies there will be a temple. Remember you not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? Don't you remember that when I was with you, I already told you this? And now you know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. The phrase, what withholdeth, implies something is preventing these events. This also indicates there is a time for his appearing or revelation. Although this may simply be speaking in general of the last days, the time of his foretold activity. For the mystery of iniquity does already work. Only he who now lets will let, until he be taken out of the way. In the previous verse, something is withholding or preventing the Antichrist being revealed. We also saw the term was apostasy and not harpazo or rapture. But then this verse introduces he who now lets, changing the something to someone or someones who prevent his appearing, until he be taken out of the way. Evidently, this one who lets or allows will be taken out of the way. I believe there are equal arguments for this being the Holy Spirit or the Christians or both. The argument it is the Holy Spirit alone, however, is weak because it makes Jesus a liar. And then, establishing a clear sequential relationship. And then shall that wicked be revealed. The that wicked, meaning the man of sin, the son of perdition, then he shall be revealed. Huh? Just keeping a completely open mind here, we have the following. From verse 3, the day of the Lord shall not come until after falling away first and the Antichrist revealed. And in verse 8, Antichrist not revealed until after he who lets is removed. This kind of means these two are out of time order. Looking at verse 8 first, he who lets is removed and then Antichrist is revealed. And in verse 3, Antichrist has been revealed, falling away has happened, then the day of the Lord can happen. I would also take this to mean the day of the Lord is his final return with his saints. And then shall that wicked be revealed. Heads up, a big parenthetical description is about to follow. Whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. This is describing the fate of the man of sin, the son of perdition, the Antichrist. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders. Now, I find the King James a bit unclear in the usage of the pronoun him, as in even him. The Berean Study Translation, the coming of the lawless one will be accompanied by the working of Satan with every kind of power, sign, and false wonder. The International Standard Version, the coming of the lawless one will be accompanied by the power of Satan. He will use every kind of power, including miraculous signs and lying wonders. The thing I take away is that signs and wonders will happen. They will happen with the coming of the Antichrist to support him. Will they be performed by the false prophet Isa of Islam? It would seem consistent for a false prophet to present deceiving signs and wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. Let's look at this phrase, the deceivableness of unrighteousness, in them that perish. Stated another way, those that perish are easy to deceive because of their unrighteousness. Have you ever heard the phrase, you cannot cheat an honest man? Honesty prevents you from taking shortcuts with dangerous behaviors. Likewise, unrighteous or dishonest men will easily be tricked by a deceptive scheme. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. received not. If you have free will, free choice, you must receive it. You must willingly accept the love of the truth. Even though the love of the truth is free, it is neither cheap nor easy. There is indeed a price to pay in humility, possible shame, even humiliation. But it is the price, for lack of a better word, we seem to be required to pay. Matthew 10:33, "But whoever denies me before men, I also will deny before my Father who is in heaven." Luke 12:9, "But he who denies me before men will be denied before the angels of God." Remember, Jesus is the truth. If you deny Jesus, you are rejecting the truth. It is not my place to judge if this condemns one under 2 Thessalonians 2:9. But I want to stay far away from that line of demarcation. John 3:19, "And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that does evil hates the light, neither comes to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that does truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest that they are wrought or worked in God." Remember, they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that all might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. This is a rather terminal event. If you do not choose to love the truth, this strong delusion will seal your fate. So what is the actual strong delusion? I'll get to some theories in the next video. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.